Hello and welcome. You're watching Head to Head. I'm Carrie Oderman with UATV. Ukraine's improving financial stability and renewed commitment to reform has pushed a leading Wall Street firm to upgrade the country's debt rating. New York-based Fitch Ratings raised Ukraine's long-term foreign and local currency debt to B from B- with a positive outlook. At the same time, the country is expected to reach a new loan deal with the International Monetary Fund to help meet a spike in debt repayments in 2020 and 2021. To talk more about the economics as well as the business climate in Ukraine, we're joined in the studio today by James Brooke, editor-in-chief of the Ukraine Business News. James, thanks for joining us.
All right, thanks.
What does the improvement in the Fitch rating mean for Ukraine? Just give us an overview.
Very quickly, it's a recognition of what should have been done probably 6 months ago, which is that Ukraine's finances are quite solid. And with this unprecedented pairing of the president and the parliament, the same party, the political outlook is quite good for continued reform. And it's a reformist government. So bottom line, it's very good. And the two other agencies will follow shortly, I'm sure.
But 6 months ago, it was a different government. Can the Zelensky administration really take credit for this? Or is this something that Poroshenko did and the Zelensky government is now reaping the benefits?
Correct. Zelensky is inheriting a very good macroeconomic situation. And Poroshenko did enormous groundwork, which I'm happy to report the Zelensky government appears to want to build on. They're not, they've done a little bit of trash talking their predecessor, but now they want to build on the reforms. And that's very exciting because people would say that Ukraine reformed more in 5 years than in the previous 5 years, 25 years. So that is a real plus that the new government is building on the reforms.
As someone that's observing the entire business environment here, do you really have the indication that Zelensky's administration is going in the right direction? They didn't have much of a policy platform when they got elected. It was a group of people that we weren't sure were going to agree on which way they were going.
Right, Carrie. It was a bit of a black box. Voters voted for Zelensky because they knew him and they didn't like Poroshenko. But I think last week with the president's speech to the parliament and then the new prime minister's briefing of the press, the jack-in-the-box has popped out of the box. And the jack-in-the-box is a libertarian jack-in-the-box. And there are some stunning free market changes that are going to be hitting this country in the next 100 days. I'm talking about Europe's largest land market, major privatizations, casino gambling, but more importantly, opening up for private sector investment in ports, airports, highways, railroads, private locomotives on private freight trains. It's really important. So we're seeing a major change for Ukraine this fall.
Well, in the past, investors have had a little bit of anxiety about coming into Ukraine. The conflict in the Donbas, the undeclared war that Russia has with Ukraine, the Crimean Peninsula being annexed. How does Zelensky's administration calm down potential investors?
Well, on the war front, if we look at the Donbas, I think the Saturday's prisoner swap, it was the first swap in 2 years, and it was big, and it was very emotional. And frankly, it was very interesting to see how the two countries played it. Here, it was a somewhat chaotic, friendly, very emotional scene at the airport, the president there, and the mothers and wives, and everyone was there, kids, the press, real bit of a chaos scene there, but very open. And we saw the profiles of each man who'd been in prison, for some for as long as 5 years. The Russian side, all we saw was a photo of 25 guys in a tent with their faces deliberately blurred. It's kind of creepy. It's like, you know, welcome back to North Korea. So very much a different play, the open society and the closed society. But that, I think, is a key symbolic step in what ideally will be a gradual stepping down of the military conflict, which only affects 3% of the national territory, if you forget about Crimea for the moment. 3% of the national territory are the occupied areas of Donetsk and Luhansk. It's a big country. It's larger than France. So you just have a little corner that is in conflict.
What kind of investors have shown not to be affected by this type of anxiety, this type of worry about the conflict? Who's coming into Ukraine already? Who are the early settlers, so to speak?
Well, you look at Ukraine's big advantage, you know, this huge amount of black earth soils and the agricultural sector. So you have Cargill and the world's largest grain traders, not just trading grain, but investing hundreds of millions of dollars in new ports in the Black Sea, new terminals. And then you have in the IT sector, I think Ukraine is now the largest destination for British companies to outsource IT. So a lot of IT people come in. And we're now seeing tourists. I live in the center of tourism and Golden Gate. And every day I see knots of tourists, you know, French, Italian, American. So we're seeing people coming in. And the important thing is people come here and they realize that 97% of the country is totally quiet and normal.
How the new prime minister, Oleksiy Honcharuk, he was happy about the Fitch's rating, and he said that Ukraine is on the right path. What kind of advice would you give him to keep bringing investors in?
Well, stay on that path and keep opening. They are opening tremendous opportunities. In the 2020s, we will see Europe's largest farmland market in this country, 40 million hectares. It's huge. You will see in the next 2, 3, 4 years, the largest privatization of state companies in recent memory in the former Soviet Union. So if you stay on track, they will come. And I think people were very impressed by the president when he addressed the Rada. He was very specific about who was to do what and what the timetables were. There was no ambiguity there. You know, we want the inland river waterway bill done by November 1st. And that's your responsibility, pointing to the infrastructure minister. So we have specific targets, specific deadlines, and this will be like Roosevelt's first 100 days. It'll be a very busy time.
Well, now when Roosevelt was president of the United States, there was a depression going on and he was trying to pull his people out. Are there some concerns that classic libertarianism with low barriers will just help the people that already have the money and not the average Ukrainian?
Ideally, all boats will rise. They're opening up opportunities for billions of dollars in investment, and I mean better jobs and better pay for everybody. In the case of the farmland market, they've obviously been very cautious. The moratorium's been in place for 20 years, no farmland sales. But the World Bank has been working with the Agriculture Ministry and others for about 2 years to craft a bill that would promote small and medium farms, help them get credit to buy land, and also to restrict flipping of land so people, speculators, don't buy land and then sell it 6 months later for twice the price. And initially, there will be limits on land size and limits to Ukrainian citizens and Ukrainian companies.
Let's talk some numbers. The new prime minister wants to increase the economy by 40%. He wants inflation to go down to 5%. Is this going to be possible?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, the economy already has grown by 40% if you compare the GDP numbers. I think what's more interesting is getting into that Eastern European tiger category of 5 and 7%, which some of the neighbors have experienced, Poland, Romania, and it's entirely doable. And once again, I think Poroshenko set the basis for that, and we will see that kind of investment coming in, and we will see that kind of growth.
Is there any other advice you'd give to the cabinet or the Zelensky administration?
You know, stick to your guns and get foreigners in here. The Ukraine Business News talks to foreign investors, real and potential. It's basically a very fact-based email. It comes out Monday through Friday. And it's very strong on facts and short on opinions. And these are the building blocks for investment. And once again, the key is to get people here and see, A, what a pleasant place it is, how a lot of smart people, mm-hmm. and how there are tremendous opportunities.
When a business person calls you and wants advice, what kind of advice do you give them?
Let's have coffee. I mean, last Monday, I had a French guy in town who was doing due diligence for a French company that was thinking of investing hundreds of millions of dollars. And we had coffee. And then at noon, I had lunch with the British agent for a real estate developer. And then at 4 o'clock, I met with a Swedish-American lawyer who's interested in investing here. The real advice is come here. They're usually talking to me because they're already reading my newsletter, but if they don't, I'd say, wwbn.news. But I would say come here, check it out. Even just come for a weekend. I mean, Ukraine is so easy to visit nowadays. Yeah. It has direct flights to 50 countries, cities in Europe, and has no visa for the entire EU and for the US and Canada. So come for the weekend.
Let's talk quickly about the EU. With Brexit looming at the end of October, I've noticed that there's been a lot of interest from the British side, meeting with the Zelensky administration, talking about investments. Your take on what the UK might do with future cooperation here?
Well, oddly, there could be a little upside for Ukraine in Brexit, in that people don't realize this, but the UK is Europe's largest food importer, and Ukraine is Europe's largest food exporter. Okay. So it's a marriage made in heaven. You just get the French and German farmers out of the way and trade will go like a house of fire. There is a UK-Ukraine free trade pact that is being drawn up. Obviously, if you're in London, the Foreign Office, it's priority number 32, but it shouldn't be that hard to do, and that may well happen. But there's great potential for direct food trade, and food is the number one export of Ukraine.
Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. Jim, I'd love to have you back again.
Thank you, Carrie.
That was James Brooke, editor-in-chief of the Ukraine Business News. Thank you for watching, and stay tuned for more with UATV.